What up, meatheads? This is Travis, American Butcher, and this is the Meat Block Podcast. And if you're new to the podcast, well, welcome. And if you're joining us again, thanks for coming back. And if you enjoyed this show, all I ask is that you type in the Meat Block into your Apple Podcast search, whatever. Leave 5 stars, and please leave a comment. This episode is about canning, about food preparation, getting us through the lean times. So without any further delay, let's start the show.
Businesses have to keep a skeleton crew to get through the slow months of the winter. So a lot of meat cutters get canned, get put on the shelf. If you're a meat cutter and you just got canned, it's okay to feel a little salty about it. Or a little pickled. Now's a good time to have a smoke as a cure for your mood.
Good cutting enhances the quality of good meat. In his way, the meat cutter is an artist. Poor cutting results in a variety of meat, regardless of quality.
Bunzl Processor Division has been in the food processing and packaging industry for over 135 years, offering over 35,000 of high-quality products designed specifically to meet the needs of the meat processing, butchery, food processing, janitorial, and industrial industries. BPD also specializes in packaging equipment and supplies, offering the Multivac P-Series line of chamber packaging machines as well as the Clarity line of shrink bags, rollstock films, and vacuum pouches. They have numerous product experts, and they offer free UPS ground shipping on orders of $400 or more. Curing food and preserving food and canning food and keeping it longer has contributed man's expansion. Our migration, if you will. Coming from hunter-gatherers, then into cultivators, we needed a way to preserve what we were harvesting. We developed sun-drying and smoking, such as fish and raisins. Then we developed preserving things in salt, which at one point in our history made salt more valuable than gold. It's ironic that today's staple, meat, avocado, seasonal things that used to be seasonal, mangoes, pears, pineapple, were yesterday's delicacies, where we'd have to wait for something to be ripe, where we didn't have multiple seasons happening around the world at once, where we are limited by what was in our own backyard. Back then, when food was scarce, we were hungry. When it was plentiful, we ate. If there was a bad harvest or a bad hunt, we did without. Bread was the staff of life. It was often the appetizer, main course, and dessert. All cultures around the world have independently developed bread from some grain or another and added it to their diet. Once the spice route was established, people started trying to preserve food with rosemary, cinnamon, cumin, and many others. As spices became more valuable, this is what started some Europeans looking for a shorter route to India and discovering a continent that had already been discovered several times. Imagine, if you will, centuries ago, you're on a transatlantic trip in a ship with a bunch of scurvy-infested men and women. And your food consists of water, vinegar, olive oil, molasses, some cheese, honey, raisins, rice, garlic, almonds, sea biscuits, dried legumes, such as chickpeas, salted and brined sardines, anchovies, and salted beef and pork. If you were in the military back then, you weren't doing much better either. Armies often spent more time foraging and hunting as they did fighting. Famine and malnutrition often killed more people than battle itself. In 1809, Nicholas Affair won a contest put on by the French government. In 1809, during Napoleon's march across Europe, the French government put word that they will pay anyone 12,000 francs to develop a way to make food safe and easy to transport to the front lines. Nicholas Affair, a French chef, came up with modern canning as we know it today. The general practice was food tightly sealed in a container, thoroughly heated, would keep for years. Napoleon got the statues, while Nicholas, spending all of his money to perfect canning, died a poor man. But he did not die in vain. His discovery helped man eat right and helped them get their three square meals a day. Although canning had a long way to go, the next big advancement in canning was the tin can. This was by Peter Durant. In the 1820s, canning, like all great things, reached America when a man named William Underwood set up a cannery in Boston. But cans were still made by hand. They were still rolled with hand-cranked machines. We were just barely entering the Industrial Revolution, and certainly the Industrial Revolution was not in America yet. So the can was for luxury items until machinery advanced the technology. Cans worldwide were also still used on ships and voyages. John Franklin, an explorer, discovering a North Passage through the North Pole, brought two ships with several years worth of canned foods on board. This was in case they got stuck in the ice or needed to explore on foot. Everyone was aware of the potential danger of the mission. But one of the dangers would not be starving to death. 129 of these men died on that trip. After getting stuck in the ice, they ate their canned supplies. They did not run out of food. They went mad. Some of them walking into the snow. Some of them falling sick and dying in their sleep. The surviving men were rescued. The ships abandoned. And some years later, modern scientists exhumed the fallen that were still buried in the ice, did the toxicology and tested the cans themselves and found that they all were poisoned slowly by the cans made of lead. I guess they were still perfecting the techniques back then. But canning continued. Invention exceeded invention. Soon machines were able to do more than an hour than what a team of men could do in a month. The can had become mechanized just in time for the great expansion west. One of the most important inventions came in 1874 when A.K. Schreiber invented retort pressure cooker. The high pressure of the retort reduced the cooking time of most foods from hours to minutes. When efficiencies are found and things are streamlined, and more abundant, cost goes down, entering the double-edged sword of modern living. Overfishing, non-diversified crops such as corn, peas, green beans, away with went planning for the season. gone was harvest parties and slaughtering. Companies like Hormel's pork, and with the rapid spread of the refrigerated boxcar, human population was on the rise. Generations were healthier than previous generations, and everyone was about 3 inches taller. Americans open up well over 100 million containers a day. And how did all this get into cans, you ask?
Machines, of course, help make it possible. Every cannery contains dozens of intricate, specially designed machines. But the real backbone of the canning industry is the more than 500,000 people involved. A half million people. Who are they? They're the cannery workers, with their busy, wonderfully skilled hands. Hands that clean. Hands that trim. Hands that sort. That inspect. That pack. There are the farmers and the ranchers. The men who harvest. There are the fishermen, leading their hard and dangerous lives so that we may have choice seafoods the year round.
After World War II, America had a growing middle class, people looking for work. These were your cannery workers, but looking for improvements, looking to make things more cost-effective, more streamlined, more mechanized. These workers are no longer there. Yes, a handful of them are. One thing to think about is when you're at a grocery store and you grab a can of corn or Vienna sausage or a cheeseburger, because that also comes in a can, or a whole cooked chicken, or a bunch of fish eggs. Think about the farmers, the scientists, the cannery workers, the machines, all the steps that helped get that to you, the consumer. This next piece is by Ryan.
As Travis and David are getting after conversation about canning and winter preparation, food storage, food preservation in this episode, I couldn't help but find it kind of funny when I thought about another definition of canning, the word canning, which is when someone gets fired and laid off, they get canned, right? And that happens to be a motif in the small business side of the custom in the USDA cut and wrap facility niche, a motif at this time of year, because as the fall workload drops off of game processing, a lot of heavy farm kill, a lot of heavy flow of work, businesses gotta downsize their crew, reduce the number of people that are working there so they can get by and have lower overhead during the slow months of the wintertime. The fall harvest season can be a bottleneck, as we discussed in previous episodes. And everyone who works in this, in the seasonal side of the meat industry and the farming industry, understands the fall harvest season can be a bottleneck. There's a lot of work to do. Farmers are involved in the last moments of finishing the animals and organizing and communicating with customers. Slaughtermen have full schedules. Their winches and hoists are humming along, trying to keep a pace, trying to knock accurately, trying to avoid cutting themselves as they cruise through a multitude of animals with thick fat that will grace some family's holiday table. Meat cutters and carcass breakers dig themselves out of full coolers, bursting at the gills with an excess of hanging meat or turkeys and rib roasts. Everyone is trying to stay organized and stay steady through the endurance marathon that's November and December. And then, all of a sudden, daylight breaks through. The tidal wave dissipates. You've made it through the bottleneck. As butchers, slaughtermen, and meat cutters, we are at the eye of the food production hurricane. When our work is complete, once we've passed through the bottleneck of killing, cutting, and wrapping, who then do we hand the torch to? Who then do we hand off the workload to? It's the wide net of the culinary. Whether in the home kitchen, the commercial kitchen, or the production facility, the culinary must be ready to receive the array of foods that unfurl from the butcher's blade. Even one animal carcass provides such a vast amount of food preparation possibilities. One carcass, whether it be a farm kill or wild game kill, like a blank paper, can be folded into unlimited origami shapes. Creativity knows no ceiling. Typically, a carcass could be divided among several families. Right? I'm stating the obvious here. Carcass could be divided among several families, such as in eighths, quarters, and sixteenths, what have you. Or it could be cached to feed one family through the winter. We, at our house, have a chest freezer filled with meat levels that wax and wane through the year. When a good deal comes up on half or whole of beef, pork, or lamb, I'll spend an afternoon in the cut shop or in the garage creating steaks and roasts for the deep freeze. Now, as a one-man show with a gaggle of kids who you may or may not hear in the background here, the gaggle of kids who use my last name, I personally am thankful for the easy meat preservation that a chest freezer offers. Because, so for me, butchering day is spent cutting and wrapping, and my culinary work is then put off to another day because everything's in a deep freeze. This is a modern luxury. In earlier times, before the advent of refrigeration, butchering and meat preservation work would need to happen simultaneously. And that is the focus of this episode. The culinary and preservation techniques that would need to happen in pre-refrigeration times in human history, which is the majority of human history. So how the heck do you preserve food, meat, different types of food? How do you preserve foods without freezing and refrigeration? I'm going to read from the book called Preserving Wild Foods by Matthew Weingarten and Raquel Pelzel. The book's called Preserving Wild Foods. For millennia, people have been pickling and preserving as a way to extend the harvest and provide food and comforts during the cold winter. Before there were the catchphrases, seasonal, locavore, and farm to table, what these words describe was the everyday reality of survival, how to make food last. But with refrigeration and freezing, as well as vacuum sealing and industrial canning, preserving the bounty of the season isn't a necessity, but it sure is delicious and fun to do. Approach canning and preserving with joy and excitement, not trepidation and fear. That said, there's nothing wrong with checking the playbook for a game plan. For the most precise rundown of USDA guidelines for canning and curing, check out the National Center for Home Food Preservation at nchfp.uga.edu. Canning, also known as boiling water bath processing. All right. This method is when fruits and vegetables are packed with liquid into sterilized jars. The jars are submerged in boiling water and held there to destroy any microorganisms and to expel air, which is necessary for microorganisms to live. The jars are removed from the water, and as they cool, the lids compress and create a vacuum seal, preserving the integrity of what is inside. The next method is salt curing. Salt curing involves coating a large piece of meat or fish with salt and spices to draw out moisture and eliminate an environment friendly to bacteria. Note, some recipes call for part salt, part sugar to achieve a more tender, less salty product. Okay, so that was salt curing. Next is sugar curing method. This method of preservation, which is used most often for fruits, also draws out moisture. The process is slightly different, however, in that the moisture in the form of sugar syrup is almost always reintroduced to the fruit. This gives a more intense and pure flavor in the finished preserve. That was sugar curing. Next is oil curing. In oil curing, items already cured are covered with oil or natural animal fat to seal in flavor and create an impenetrable barrier against microbes, moisture, and air. This is a great technique to use for duck confit, fish, and vegetables. It is crucial that Whatever you plan to submerge in oil is thoroughly cured beforehand, as some forms of spoilage, specifically botulism, thrive in an anaerobic, which is an airless, environment. This explains health regulations dictating never to store raw garlic in oil. Garlic is known to harbor the botulinum toxin. Okay, that was oil curing. Now, pickling. Pickling. This method of preservation involves packing raw, blanched, or cooked food into jars, covering the contents with an acidic salt solution. Bacteria and molds don't grow in a high acid environment. Sometimes pickled foods are further heat treated in the jars by processing in a boiling water bath, which is canning. This extends their shelf life. Okay. Last method we'll mention is smoking. Often used in conjugation with dry curing, smoking inhibits spoilage through dehydration and the creation of a smoke covering that consists of the natural oils of the wood as well as carbon. This combination creates a hostile environment for microbial growth. The authors then offer a word on ingredient choices for preservation. Fruits and vegetables should be unblemished, meaning no bruises, soft spots, holes, or gashes. They should be as fresh as possible. Fruit and vegetables intended for pickling are best slightly underripe, and for jamming or preserving, they're best a hair overripe. Always wash and dry fruits and vegetables before using. Meat and seafood should also be as fresh as possible, preferably butchered on-site at the moment of purchase or at home, if that's where you're doing your butchering. Try to purchase a whole fish and have the fishmonger fillet it for you before wrapping it up. The same applies to whole joints. If you don't plan to bone the muscle at home, ask the butcher to do it for you. The idea is the more surface area exposed to air, the more likely it is that bacteria will latch on and grow. Limiting the exposure slows spoilage. The authors go on to provide detailed equipment lists and step-by-step processes for all these different methods throughout the book. The only one that I'm going to talk about from here is I'm going to spend a brief moment talking about oil curing. And in this case, the authors offer a duck confit recipe. Confit is the use of an oil or a fat from preservation. I really like fat curing, and so I wanted to spend a minute reading what the authors have to say about it. There's a reason that duck confit is on the menu at every French bistro. The least expensive way for a restaurant to purchase duck is whole, then it is butchered on site. The breasts are the choice cuts, and although they're delicious, the chef is left with more than half the bird, being the drumsticks and thighs. Cooking those cuts low and slow in a pot of duck fat transforms them into rich and fork-tender meat that's full of flavor. In addition, and here's the magic, the thighs and drumsticks can be preserved in the fat for months, thereby minimizing waste and maximizing profit. Preserving meat in fat is an ancient curing method. In cold climates around the world, ceramic crocks are still buried beneath the earth, where they are kept for many months to come. I imagine a farm wife in northern France trudging through the snow, unearthing a crock, removing as many legs as she needs, and then carefully resealing the legs with a fresh layer of duck fat. Storing food in the cold earth was the first form of refrigeration. It's nature's icebox. The first time you make duck confit, you'll have to buy some already rendered duck fat unless you save the fat from cooking the breasts. After cooking that first batch of the confit, however, you'll end up with a nice supply to use in more ways than you could ever anticipate. Duck fat keeps indefinitely in the fridge as long as it's sealed so it doesn't absorb any odors. Confit fat gets better with time. The flavor deepens as it ages. Like a bread starter or a vinegar mother, some of the confit fat in my refrigerator probably goes back a decade. One of the great things about roasted duck confit is that after the confit process is complete, the leg itself, once removed and crisped in a pan, is fairly lean, even as it remains succulent and ducky. And the duck fat, well, there are countless uses for it. I love it for making extra crisp pan-fried or roasted potatoes, roasting vegetables, basting steaks, and poaching meaty fish such as wild striped bass, tuna, and swordfish. The most curious use for duck fat, however, is in the purview of my wife. Never heard that word, purview. And all the other women who swear by traditional Eastern European remedies. In winter, at the first signs of chest cold, she applies a nice smear of duck fat across her chest as if it were Vicks Vapor Rub. She doesn't discriminate. She'll use goose fat for this purpose, too. It's my favorite perfume, and we together suffer. She from her cold, and I because her remedy makes me hungry. Well, sir. Okay, so then the authors offer a citrus and spice confit of duck leg. I don't know if I'm going to read it. I suppose I will. Okay. My version of classic duck confit incorporates aromatic citrus, herbs, and spices for a bouquet that is captured and preserved by the duck fat. The addition of a small amount of sugar cures the meat without leaving it too salty. Reserve the last of the fat that renders off the crisp duck legs to smear on a piece of bread or on your wife's boobs. Now, I added that part. Or combine with a touch of mustard and red wine vinegar to dress a green salad. Into a quart-sized resealable plastic bag, put 3 tablespoons black peppercorns, 3 tablespoons whole coriander seeds, 3 tablespoons juniper berries. With the bottom of a heavy skillet, lightly crush the spices. Put 2 tablespoons in a medium bowl, reserve the rest, and add 2 tablespoons kosher salt, 2 tablespoons sugar, 2 sprigs fresh thyme. Gotta have the fresh thyme, my friends. Rub the spice mixture over 6 duck leg quarters. Put the spiced duck legs in a non-reactive roasting pan or large plastic container, cover, and refrigerate for 2 days. So, that's the 2-day cure that they're offering, where they're pre-curing with salt and sugar these duck legs, okay? 2 days in the fridge. Okay, now day 3. Preheat the oven to 200 degrees Fahrenheit. Remove the legs from the cure and with a pastry brush, wipe off the spices. Pastry brush, folks. Wipe out the roasting pan and return the legs to it. Put the reserved spice mixture in a medium bowl and add 16 garlic cloves, peeled and smashed, rind of 1 orange, pith scraped off, 5 star anise pods, lightly crushed, 5 fresh thyme sprigs, 3 rosemary, fresh rosemary sprigs, and 1/2 cinnamon sticks. Sprinkle this mixture over the duck legs in a large pot. Warm up 8 cups duck fat. So now the duck fat is warming up, turning from solid to liquid. All right. Pour the duck fat over the legs and set the roasting pan over medium-low heat. Bring the fat to a simmer, then immediately turn off the heat. Tightly wrap the pan with a few sheets of aluminum foil and put the pan in the oven. Cook until the meat is tender but not falling off the bone, which is about 3 hours. Okay, so now you just cooked the legs in the pan for 3 hours. Okay, with a slotted spoon and tongs, gently transfer the duck legs to the clean baking dish or airtight container in which you plan to store the legs. So that could be a ceramic crock, such as in the image the authors previously described of taking a big ceramic pot and putting it in the ground that has this duck fat and duck legs in it with a lid on it. Anyway, so you put the legs in a clean baking dish or airtight container in which you plan to store the legs. Pour the fat through a fine mesh sieve directly over the legs. Cover with plastic wrap or a tight-fitting lid and refrigerate for up to 1 year. So that's up to 1 year, they say, which is, this is where the preservation, food preservation point is made, is that once it's in the fat, it will last preserved in there for quite some time. To reheat the duck legs, carefully remove the fat. Use your hand to scrape off as much fat as possible. Put the duck legs on a rimmed baking sheet and broil until the skin is crisp and sizzling. So all you're doing at that point, removing the duck legs from the fat, just kind of scraping off the fat. And then you're just broiling these puppies just to get the skin crispy because they're already pre-cooked and pre-cured. So you're good to go. You're just going to crisp them up now at a high temperature. All right, folks, that's the end of that segment on confit A note is you can substitute for up to a quarter of the duck fat used to confit with a neutral oil such as grapeseed or canola. Don't substitute more than a quarter of the fat won't solidify and the legs won't confit properly. All right, take care.
Hey guys, Travis here. Just want to talk about how you could support our show is by supporting our sponsor, Bunzel Processing Division. And they offer a wide variety of disposables, everything from N95 mask disposable gloves, even equipment like Jarvis lines of captive bolts, well saws, etc.
Using animal fat as Vicks Vapor Rub is new to me. I have used fresh suet as waterproofing, and I have always noticed when I used to work slaughter that my hands were soft and supple. Like that one guy in Mice and Men who kept his one hand in a glove full of Vaseline to keep it soft for his lady. When I worked slaughter, my hands were very soft for the women, but I did not keep them in Vaseline-soaked gloves. I kept them in the carcass of a dead pig, or beef, or lamb, when I was working on the line. And segue from Mice and Men and John Steinbeck, I recently went to Monterey and visited Cannery Row. And if you don't know these references, please Google them and read both those books, Mice and Men and Cannery Row. And as I was walking the streets of Monterey with my family, my brother, and my mom, all these shops were in old canneries, where they said the shoals of sardines were so thick that it would stop ships. Monterey is a shadow of what it once was. Only skeletons of factories remain. As overfishing and fishing techniques changed, we went from pelagic species to dragging, and no longer needed the canneries on the coastline. Ships themselves became canneries. I was talking to the owner of the company that I manage. And before he got into the meat industry, he used to work aboard these massive shipping vessels for the former Soviet Union. And he would tell me that fishing boats were the same footprint as a military boat, that all ships could be equipped with guns. But during this time, the most interesting thing he told me is that food was scarce, even though these were giant canning machines. Bringing food from the Soviet Union was not always practical. So on the backs of these ships, there would be a pin with two live hogs for the crew. They would feed them fish slop and then slaughter them about a month at sea. He told me he would spend 3 months sometimes and not step off the boat, only finding harbor to unload their cargo and then going back out. But this is not a fish episode, although I would like to do one and have him be on the show. This is a canning episode. And the reason for this episode is recently I was approached by a couple on Instagram. They contacted me at American Butcher and asked me if I wanted to slaughter a hog for them. And if you're a friend of the show and have been following me online, you will know that I have worked in the slaughter industry, but I no longer do work in the slaughter industry. But I said yes, wanting to get my kitchen in my basement up and operational for vanity purposes to the hog kill. It was scheduled 2 days after Thanksgiving. I didn't own a firearm that would have been appropriate enough to harvest it, only having a .223 and .30-06, and then calibers that go up from there. I needed to get something smaller. I went to a pawn shop the day before, on Black Friday, and purchased a Savage Mark II for $120. My wife does most of my emails for me. If you get an email from me, and it's professional, and it's spelled correctly, it was not sent by me. This is the same with texting and other correspondences. I'm always given the gists and I always read them. But the response is usually done more elegantly than I would do in the written word. So when she told me the hog I was going to kill was at the KOA campgrounds, I thought there was a miscommunication, or the address they sent me was next to the KOA campgrounds. Knowing this alone would make a good story, I was more than eager to do the slaughter. With my new 22, a pair of borrowed bibs, my old slaughter knives, and my pickup truck, I drove east. After about an hour and a half in the car, I see signs for the KOA, and I'm thinking to myself, this still can't be right. Then I'm being told, in your next half mile, make a turn, and etc., until finally I'm at the gates of the campground and calling them on the phone and being let in. It was a family. It was off season. They were closed for the winter, and they were the caretakers, making sure signs were put up, things were maintained, and there wasn't loitering or unwanted visitors during the off months. They had a pig that they recently purchased. As I start setting up the hoist, the cords, the hose, the bucket of water, knowing where I'm going to put the guts, I'm talking to them. They eventually want to become farmers, farmsteaders, and we started talking about canning. They were going to render down the fat and can it, salt their own pork, make their own bacon, and preserve as much of the animal as they can, rendering bones for demis and broths, harvesting all organ meats, and doing everything possible to make sure the animal and nothing went to waste. And I started thinking to myself, right before I pulled the trigger and shot that fucker in the head, that I really don't know that much about canning. And David's a nerd, and he does. This next piece is by David.
I've gotten a few strange requests for things working in a cut shop, some of which I've mentioned in previous Nightmare episodes. You know, tartar for an 8-year-old, tenderloin for a baby, beating the hell out of a whole chicken with a cleaver, splinters and all, for curry or something like that. A couple of years ago, after I had moved to a much more rural area, I noticed that the cut sheets at the plant were, they were different. There was no more Flatiron, Denver, boneless short rib, or chuck tender. No Delmonico or chuck eye. No more blade steak. There was only chuck roast or chuck steak, both of which were the same cut, the only difference being about 2¼ inches in width. That was pretty much the story, all the way down the carcass, really. Super simple, old school cuts, with little option, and almost all of it was done on the saw. This is a bit of a tough pill to swallow, as I had been doing something more akin to craft butchery, in the sense that there was some, you know, some seaming and clean bones were of emphasis until that point. Slower, more detail-oriented, etc. One item that was on the cut sheet that I had never heard of before was canning pieces. That's just how it read, canning pieces. It had never dawned on me that people canned meat or broth as a preservation method. I mean, I come from a freezer or just put it out in the snow type of background, so this is a new concept for me. The canning pieces, as it read, were simply boneless and denuded 3-inch to 4-inch chunks of meat. I decided that I'd do a little research, and I dug into it by asking people I worked with, either co-workers or customers, people that came out to the farm, or people that I saw at the farmer's market. I even dove into a few sort of prepper-type message boards on the internet. Apparently, there's a good conversation going here. Not only can you can chunks of meat, but you can also canned bone broth, ground meat, and seasoned sausage. People can red meat, but they also can pork and poultry. and fish in some cases. Some people submerge their meat in brine or broth, marinade. Some sear it first, and some just raw pack it. And people defend their methods vehemently as if they were defending their favorite football team or something like that. Now, I had been canning pickles, preserves, ferments, and or certain just vegetables for years, much in the same way that my grandma had when I was young, in a water bath, you know, just a stock pot of boiling water. They were all generally high acidity or high sugar products, jams, chutneys, pickles, tomatoes, things like that. Raw meat or, you know, partially cooked meat really doesn't satisfy any of those things, the high acid or the high sugar or anything like that. You know, acidulating the meat enough to make it shelf-stable would render it damn near inedible and most definitely unpalatable. So how do you can meat? In short, the answer is pressure canning. And what is pressure canning, you ask? I mean, you would ask if you're here. When you have a high acid food like, say, tomatoes or something that you've pickled, the low pH combined with the exposure to temps over 212 degrees Fahrenheit or 100 degrees Celsius for our friends to the east and the west and north and south, plus a vacuum sealed environment is enough to kill botulism bacteria as well as prevent bacterial outgrowth. Low acid foods, like meat, however, must be processed in a pressure canner. The reason is that although botulism bacteria dies at 212 degrees Fahrenheit, the spores can still survive. At the much higher temps that a pressure canner can achieve, however, the spores are killed as well as E. coli and Staphylococcus bacteria. In a normal water bath canner, or say a large stock pot, water boils at 212 degrees Fahrenheit, as I mentioned, or 100 degrees Celsius. The temps that you're able to achieve while boiling in a standard water bath are limited because any extra heat turns water to steam and it's released just through the top. If you tried to can meat in a regular boiling water bath, it could take 10 to 15 hours for a couple of quarts. You consistently have to babysit it, filling it with boiling water. You run the risk of overprocessing it as well, and just having a jar of gray, overcooked material. Since water's boiling point is determined by the atmospheric pressure, by boiling water in a sealed container, you increase the pressure acting on the water because the steam can't escape. The heat source continues to apply heat to the liquid inside the vessel. Since the steam can't escape, it causes the steam and the liquid to be the same temp. As the pressure rises, it makes it much more difficult for the water molecules to escape the steam, so the temp keeps rising. And once the correct pressure and temperature is achieved, the pressure gauge indicates it. And your pressure canner is going to have some sort of pressure gauge on it, whether it's something analog or something digital. At this point, you can roll back the thermostat on the stove to save energy and maintain the temp. You can then boil your jars around 250 degrees Fahrenheit, which is hot enough to kill pathogens within a reasonable amount of time. Have you ever noticed that there are sometimes separate directions for cooking food at high elevation? Well, because of this, you must make adjustments for pressure canning in these scenarios. According to the National Center for Home Food Preservation, the boiling point of water lowers by 1 degree Fahrenheit every 540 feet of altitude or 1 degree Celsius for every 295 meters. Because of this, water can boil at a much, much lower temp than its normal 212 degree Fahrenheit temp when you're up in the mountains. So in other words, you could be quote-unquote boiling water, but majorly undercooking it, since it isn't reaching that normal boiling temp. This in turn can contribute to bacterial outgrowth and, in turn, pants shitting. When you're at higher altitudes, cook time must be increased by 5% for every 980 feet above 2,000 feet elevation. The effects of this phenomenon are documented by Charles Darwin in The Voyage of the Beagle, March 20th, 1835. Having crossed the Pyrenees, we descended into a mountainous country, intermediate between the two main ranges, and then took up our quarters for the night. We were now in the Republic of Mendoza. The elevation was probably not under 11,000 feet, 3,400 meters. At the place where we slept, water necessarily boiled, from the diminished pressure of the atmosphere at a lower temperature than it does in a less lofty country. Hence, the potatoes, after remaining for some hours in the boiling water, were nearly as hard as ever. The pot was left on the fire all night. The next morning it was boiled again, but yet the potatoes were not cooked. Where did this technology come from? Well, in 1679, Denis Papin, a French physicist and mathematician, invented a new type of cooking vessel that he deemed the digester because of its fast cooking time for meats and bones. It was a cast iron cauldron with a locking lid. There was no exhaust vent. And as the water inside boiled, the pressure built, and explosions were actually quite common. It was refined further, and in 1810, upon Napoleon Bonaparte's request for a method of preserving meat and other foods at room temp for his army, a young man invented a method of heat processing glass jars of food that were sealed with wax. In 1938, Alfred Vischer invented a more modern at-home pressure cooker, and several different manufacturers kind of stole the design from him and presented them at the World's Fair the following year. From there, the design mostly stayed the same. Now, there are two major types of pressure canners. There's a classic type, which has been around for about 70 years, and you've got a stock pot with thick walls, a clamping lid, and a vent for releasing steam with an accompanying counterweight. And this is the type that I have. So you clamp the lid on, and it builds pressure, and the steam starts to come out from this little vent, this little tiny pipe, no more than, say, a third of an inch, 2.5 inches in diameter. When the steam starts leaving that vent pipe, I place a counterweight over it, and it's, you know, cleverly designed small weight that goes over the top of the vent. But it's not a clamp or a tight fit, and the pressure of the steam will actually rattle that little cap that I put on top. It won't throw it off, it'll just rattle it, and you actually time the rattles to a cadence, and when it hits a certain frequency, you know that you've hit the right temperature. You can roll back the thermostat on the stove, and you can process it for X amount of time given to you. You know, there's USDA guidelines for pressure canning, and as soon as you've, you know, cooked it for the amount of time that you have to, you can then cool it down and release the pressure. And I actually have a method here for pressure canning from the National Center for Home Food Preservation. So follow these steps for successful pressure canning. First of all, make sure the pressure canner is working properly before preparing food. Clean the lid, gaskets, and other parts according to the manufacturer's directions. Make sure all vent pipes are clear and contain no trapped material or mineral deposits. Center the canner over the burner. The burner and range must be level. Your pressure canner can be damaged if the burner puts out too much heat. In general, do not use an outdoor LP gas burner or gas range burner over 12,000 BTUs. Put the rack and the hot water into the canner. If the amount of water is not specified with a given food, use enough water so it is 2 to 3 inches high in the canner. Longer processes require more water. Some specific products, for example, smoked fish, require that you start with even more water in the canner. Always follow the directions with USDA processes for specific foods if they require more water to be added to the canner. For hot pack foods, or foods that you cook first and then attempt to can while they're still hot, you can bring the water to 180 degrees Fahrenheit ahead of time, but be careful not to boil the water or heat it long enough for the depth to decrease. For raw packed foods, the water should only be brought to 140 degrees Fahrenheit. Raw packed foods are foods that have not been pre-cooked, so we're just talking cold meat right in the jar. Place the filled jars, fitted with lids and ring bands, on the jar rack in the canner using a jar lifter. Jar lifter is kind of like a pair of kitchen pliers almost. When moving jars with the jar lifter, make sure the jar lifter is securely positioned below the neck of the jar. Keep the jar upright at all times. Tilting the jar could cause food to spill into the sealing area of the lid, thus creating an unsafe seal. Fasten the canner lid securely. Leave the weight off the vent pipe. Turn the heat setting to its highest position on the stove. Heat until the water boils and steam flows freely in a funnel shape from the open vent pipe. While maintaining the high heat setting, let the steam flow continuously for 10 minutes. After this venting or exhausting of the canner, place a counterweight on the vent pipe. The canner will pressurize during the next 3 to 10 minutes. Now, just as an aside, if you have the second type of pressure canner, the more modern and digital one, you don't have to do any of this shit. It just does it all for you, and it's cheating, if you ask me. And also extremely accurate and efficient. So there's that. Next, you want to start timing the process when the pressure reading on the dial gauge indicates that the recommended pressure has been reached, or, for canners without dial gauges, when the weighted gauge begins to jiggle or rock, as the manufacturer describes, as I mentioned before. You want to regulate the heat under the canner to maintain a steady pressure at or slightly above the correct gauge pressure. One type of weighted gauge should jiggle a certain number of times per minute, while another type should rock slowly throughout the process. Check the manufacturer's directions. The jiggly one, or the rattler, is the one that I have. Loss of pressure at any time can result in underprocessing or unsafe food. So remember that. If you're worried about the pressure and you roll back the temp too quickly, you can end up with a dangerous product. Quick and large pressure variations during processing may cause unnecessary liquid losses from the jars as well. It's very important to remember that if at any point the pressure goes below the recommended amount, you need to bring the canner back to the pressure and begin the timing of the process over from the beginning, using the total original process time. This is very, very important for the safety of the food and preventing bacterial outgrowth in the future. When the timed process is completed, turn off the heat, remove the canner from the heat, and if possible, let the canner cool down naturally. Lift the canner to move it. Do not slide it. You don't want to break anything on the inside or splash water all over the place. While the canner is cooling, it's also depressurizing. Do not force force cool the canner. You know, some people want to submerge the whole thing in ice water or what have you. Don't do it. Forced cooling may result in food spoilage. Cooling the canner with cold running water, opening the vent pipe before the canner is fully depressurized are types of forced cooling. They will also cause loss of liquid from jars and seal failures. Forced cooling may also warp the canner lid. Even after a dial gauge canner is cooled until the dial reads 0 pounds pressure, be cautious in removing the weight from the vent pipe. Tilt the weight slightly to make sure no steam escapes before pulling it all the way off. Newer canners will also have a cover lock in the lid or a handle that must release after cooling before the lids are twisted off. Don't force the lid open if the cover locks are not released. Manufacturers will generally provide detailed instructions for depressurizing and opening. After the canner is completely depressurized, remove the weight from the vent pipe. Wait 10 minutes, and then unfasten the lid and remove it carefully. Lift the lid with the underside away from you so the steam coming out of the canner does not burn your face. Using a jar lifter, remove the jars one at a time, being careful not to tilt the jars. Carefully place them directly onto a towel or cake cooling rack, leaving at least 1 inch of space between the jars during cooling. Avoid placing jars on a cold surface or in a cold draft. You want to let the jar set undisturbed while they cool from 12 to 24 hours. Do not tighten ring bands on the lids or push down in the center of the flat metal lid so that, you know, you get the little noise, whatever. Let it do it naturally. Remove ring bands from the steel jars. Ring bands can be washed and dried and put away for another time. Put any unsealed jars in the refrigerator and use those first. You know, if you have something that has a bad seal, you can just put it right in the fridge and then you can use it just for your dinner over the next week or so, unless you need to preserve it for some reason, in which case you have to start it over.
it's cold outside.
I've got to go away.
But baby, it's cold outside.
All right, meatheads, that's going to do it for this week's episode of the Meat Block. Episode 40, Canning. I hope you enjoyed it. It was fun, educational. I learned a lot, certainly, while producing it and editing it, and I hope you did too. And if you're thinking to yourself, man, that was a quality program, then I would strongly encourage you to tell a friend or share this with a friend or on social media. And speaking of social media, if you want to get a hold of us, you could email us themeatblockpodcast@gmail.com or tweet us at themeatblockpod, or the best way is Instagram, themeatblock. We also have a Facebook group, which is amazing. We're building a community, and friends of the show could ask questions, and other members of the community could answer them. There's no bullshit, there's no machismo, there's no homophobia, there's none of this garbage and xenophobia that comes with butcher pages that I realize. Read the comments on these bigger butcher groups. They're disgusting sometimes. No one has all the answers, but as a community, we could help each other to find the result your problem, or we'll do our best. And if you're thinking to yourself, man, that's all great, but I don't want to ask a forum, and I don't want to contact you guys as a group. I want to contact, let's say, Ryan. Well, you can contact Ryan on Instagram at Gather and Break. You can contact David at A Farm Butcher on Instagram. You can contact myself at American Butcher on Instagram and Facebook. And if you enjoy what you hear, or enjoying what you hear, or have enjoyed what you heard in the past, then please, like a dead horse, I'm going to beat this fucker till I can't get up. Go to the Apple Podcast app, type in the Meat Block, and leave a 5-star review. And please, please leave a comment. Now it's time for my favorite part of the show, shoutouts, where the only thing going to get butchered is your name, thanks to YMA Butcher Shop for your review on Apple Podcast. Bone Bay 124 for your review on Apple Podcast. Billy BV By for your review on Apple Podcast. Blooms 55 for your review on Apple Podcast. Thanks so much. It really means a lot. I sincerely read every review. Say you're an Android user and you don't have Apple. Another way to support us is through social media, tagging us on photos or posts. Like Lauren Lee, Rocky Red, Hog Bio, Ivanstein Farms, Grish the Filmer. Today's outro song is still Christmas country themed, and it is Willie Nelson and Norah Jones. Now, always let her go home if she wants to. Don't be creepy as fuck as Ben Crosby or Willie Nelson or many other people who covered this song. And like always, keep your knife sharp and live in the margin.
Yeah, and I really can't stay. Get over that hole now. Baby, it's cold.